Rock and Roll Geek Show 768.
Still rocking after all these years.
This is the story of my rock and roll butler.
This is it, the show that started it all. Often imitated, but never equal. From San Francisco, USA, online since 2004. Right. It's the one and only Rock and Roll Geek Show. With the original rock and roll geek, Michael Butler.
Welcome to the Rock and Roll Geek Show. My name is Michael Butler. Thanks a lot for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today is Wednesday, May 31st, 2017, when I'm recording this show. It is now 8:35 p.m. I'm a little bit excited because I just bought a new bass. It's actually not a new bass. It's an old bass. It is a, it's either a 77, 78, or 70 knot. Well, it's a Gibson RD Artist bass. I've been wanting an RD Artist for a long time. It's the letter R, the letter D, Artist. It was built, I'm not sure exactly which year. I think they made it from, I've read differing things, but this is a, it's a classic bass, and it's a really cool bass. I've been wanting one for so long. I heard they made them 77, 78, and 79. The one I got, I'm not exactly positive, but the electronics are, on all these basses are made by the Moog. They're Moog Electronics. Gibson tried this bass out, from what I read. They put it out 1 year, and it was a dismal failure, so they didn't leave it out for very long. But now it's an extremely sought-after guitar, and they go for... I've seen them go for anything from like $1,600 to like $5,000 on eBay and on Reverb.com and stuff. I got this one for $850. It's not bad. Somebody tried modifying it by putting a third pickup in it. Fortunately, they didn't cut too much out. They just drilled a little hole in it, which I don't mind if a bass has a little bit of stuff like that, as long as it sounds good and looks cool. And I think the bass looks extremely cool. It looks a little bit like a Thunderbird, but it doesn't have that headstock. When I get a new bass, that's when I look forward to going to band practice. Other than that, I don't really like going to band practice too much. This is a blonde one. This is one of the maple, like blonde basses. Some of them have the rosewood fingerboard. This one has a maple fingerboard, which if I had my choice, I would get a black one or a Tobacco Summers. I might see if Billy Rowe can paint it, but it might look a little bit weird with a painted sunburst and a maple neck. I don't know. I'm going to see what Billy will do it for. Looking forward to trying it out. They supposedly sound really good. I can't tell until I plug it into my bass rig, but it certainly does look cool, and it's heavy as shit, so I'm excited about that. All right, just a little update on my day. I just now got this thing at like 6:30 p.m., so I'm a little bit, I've been fucking with it and haven't had any time to prepare the show. So we are going to wing it tonight, my friends. I just got the new Danzig. I think I might do a track-by-track on Danzig. That might be fun to goof on. We will see. But before we go into the show, I'm going to start off with a song by Ginger Wildheart. This is the folk album he just put out, Ghost in the Tanglewood. This song is called The Reaper.
You can bet your ass that your death is coming. As sure as God, mere guilt and regret. You could wear out the leather on your good boots running. I'll go fetch your best chair and just sit there. Cancer is a mean one in anyone's eyes, but at least it means you get to say goodbye. And like being a civilian casualty in a meaningless war, no one knows what they die for. The Reaper don't mind the way it, and you can bet your life that he don't dare.
There you go. Very short, very sweet. That is one of my favorite albums so far this year. I really like that album a lot, Ghosts in the Tanglewood, Ginger. All right. Before we go into the donors, actually, while we go into the donor segment, thank people who donated, I want to say rest in peace to legendary Greg Almond. Maybe we'll do, let me see, let me put some Greg Almond in the background here. I know this song from Pat Travers. Greg Allman lived the rock and roll life. I don't know if you know that story about when Cher married him, like 2 days after they got married, he passed out in a plate of spaghetti or something at a party, at a dinner party, and she divorced him. Like I think she had the marriage annulled or something. That guy lived the life. And if I talked about this on Mad at Dad, somebody posted on the Rock and Roll Geek forums that Greg Allman, this was about a month ago, somebody posted on the forums that Greg Allman was on his deathbed in hospice and getting ready to die. And his manager came on and said, contrary to popular belief, Greg Allman is not in hospice. He is home resting comfortably and cannot wait to get out on tour or something to that effect. And I said on Mad at Dad, just because he's not in hospice doesn't mean he's not on his deathbed. So he could be home resting in his deathbed. And Saturday he died. That's what happens, friends. I went to see Lynyrd Skynyrd way, way, way back. That was like the first concert my mom ever took me to at this place called Greenfield Stables. It was like a keg party, free show. It was Lynyrd Skynyrd. And I just found out, I think that this is true. My stepfather, John, told me also at that show were the Allman Brothers. So actually, the Allman Brothers could have been the first show I ever went to in my entire life. Don't remember it. Kind of remember a little bit. I kind of remember Lynyrd Skynyrd a little bit. I was like, I don't know, maybe 10 years old. This was probably like 1972. So I would have been, about 11 years old. Allman Brothers, a little bit before my time. I like the band, but I'm not that much of an authority on them. One thing for sure, they pretty much invented Southern rock, so you got to give it to them for that. If there were no Allman Brothers, there would definitely be no Lynyrd Skynyrd or Molly Hatchet. And they pretty much were one of the forefront of the jam band things. They were like one of the first jam bands. I guess they might have been a little bit after Grateful Dead, but they were right in there. One of their songs on Eat a Peach, I think, was like 35 minutes long. And of course, this song covered by Pat Travers. This is a cover of a old blues song. Who originally did this? Blind Willie McTell, I think, who did this. Whew, pulled that one out of my ass. All right. Let me thank the donors while we pay tribute to Greg Allman. Oh, one more thing about the Allman Brothers. Thin Lizzy got the dual guitar harmonies from the Allman Brothers. Listen to this song. Let me see if I can find the song that I'm looking for. Could it be this one? This is just an example with the dual guitar harmonies. All right. Thank you very much, friends, for donating to the Rock and Roll Geek Show. Without your donations, this show would die horrible, putrid. In hospice, not in hospice, resting comfortably at home on my deathbed. Death. There are several ways to donate to the show, friends. If you don't have any money, you can just go to Amazon. You can click the Amazon link on the rockandrollgeek.com at rockandrollgeek.com. Click the Amazon link. Purchase anything. I'll get a kickback. That's one way to donate. You can also donate on Patreon. Go to patreon.com/rnrgeek. Like these people did. So what else can I find from the Allman Brothers here? How about... about this one? All right, this is a good one. Ain't but one way out, baby! Patreon.com/RNRGeek. Like Michael Street is a new donor on Patreon. Every episode now that I put on Patreon, Michael Street gives me $5. Thank you, Michael Street. Thank you, Ken Kennedy, also gives me $5 every episode. Thank to Chiaki Hinohara of the Metal Moment podcast and the Japanese Metalhead Show. My good friend, one of my best friends, Chiaki Hinohara. My bromance dude. My cooking buddy. Just my friend. Just an all-around great guy and my great friend. Also, Brian Springer donates $5 on Patreon every episode. My good friend and podcast mentor, Dave Slusher, and co-host of Mad at Dad, donates $5 every episode on Patreon. Betty Wood donates $3 every episode on Patreon. Dan P., $2. Mario Zoth, Zothy9 on the forums at Rock on the Rock and Roll Geek iPhone. The Rock and Roll Geek Facebook page, which I did not create, but I do maintain and approve people. This pretty much is what Lynyrd Skynyrd stole their whole sound from, this song. Bruce McMillan donates $2 on Patreon every episode. Eric Stowell, $2. Robert Harvey, $2. John Richardson, $1. Corey Kohler, $1. And Chili Monk, Rishi Garizilla, donates $1 on Patreon. How about this one? Let's see. This one. Did I already play this one? Little hippie music, but the guys were great players, man. Dickie Betts and Dwayne Allman. The two of those guys together were great players. Is that who played together? Or did Dickie Betts replace Dwayne Allman? I don't know. I don't know the timeline of the Allman Brothers. Or this one. Let's do this one here. This is a good one. You can also donate on PayPal. There's a link at rockandrollgeek.com. Like Zach Urlacher donated $6. Patrick Shanahan donated $20. Thanks, Patrick Shanahan. Let me take this fine Tecate to you in a baby blue powder-coated Yeti knockoff koozie. Thanks to my first girlfriend, Elodie Johns, for the $20. Thanks to Sherry Jeff Filalicki for the $10. I think it's Jeff, but I'm going to thank him and his wife, Sherry. Paul Fondery for the $10. Thanks James Venners for the $10. Thanks to Jason Shepard for the $10. Thanks to Todd Cunningham for the $10. Thanks to my friend and friend of the show, Todd Cunningham, for the $10. I feel like I'm dying. Thanks to BJ Lisco for the $10. Thanks to my good friend and friend of the show, Ralph Miller, for the $10. Thanks to Dave Jackson and the School of Podcasting for the $10. Thanks to Craig Vasiloff for the $5. Thanks to Sigmund Heidacher for the $5. Thanks to Brett Garski for $5. Thanks to John Offenloch for the $5. Thanks to Stephen Mascord for the $5. Michael Street also donated on PayPal $5. Thanks to friend of mine and friend of the show, Christopher Del Grande, for the $5. Thanks to Eric Lentz for the $5. Thanks to Dean Gillespie for the $5. By the way, Greg Allman buried right next to his brother, Dwayne Allman, and one of the other guys in the band. I don't remember. Barry, somebody? I don't know everybody in the Allman Brothers. I'm not an authority on the Allman Brothers. But Greg Allman, real deal. And just for that story of him nodding off in a plate of spaghetti with Cher, that's pretty hardcore. Lived the life from early 20s till he died. Thanks to Eric Lentz for the $5. Thanks to Dean Gillespie for the $5. Thanks to Douglas Free for $5. Thanks to Kelly Mitchell for $5. Thanks to Douglas Free for the $5. Thanks to Richard Strom for the $5. Andrew Howell for the $5. Thanks to Dale Roller for the $5. Thanks to Jer O'Carroll for the $5. Thanks to, again, to Kelly Mitchell again for $5. Thanks to Jeff C.A. for the $5. Thanks to David Ivey for the $5. Thanks to John Tennis for the $5. Thanks to Douglas Free for $5. Thanks to John Boveri for $5. Thanks to Peter Spark for the $2. Thanks to Bradford Page for the $2. Thanks to John Skiller for the $2. Thanks to Jeffrey Cannaparoli for the $2. Thanks to Lassie Satvedhagen for the $2. Thanks to Deborah Dreyfus, if that's your real name, for the $2. Thanks to Richard Fusey for the $2. Thanks to Adrian Boshon, Bosh Rock on the forums and on the Rock and Roll Geek Facebook page, which I did not create, but I do approve people. Go to Facebook and look for Rock and Roll Geek Show Facebook page. And finally, thanks to Michael Mack, friend of the show, for the $2. Sometimes I feel. Thanks to everybody who donated. Please keep the donations coming. Without your donations, this show would die horrible, putrid, stench-filled death. All right. By the way, I want to apologize for my chair squeaking. I've just been alerted by a listener that my chair squeaks. I apologize, but hey, what are you going to do? I don't have any WD-40. Is it squeaking? Yeah, it's kind of. Sometimes I don't really notice it right now. All right, you want to do a track by track? Should I do a Biter's show review or a track by track of? Let's do a Biter show review first. How about that? Let's see.
Hey, Michael Butler. This is Ken from Orange County, New York, calling in with a show review of the Biters.
Ken went to see Dan Baird and Homemade Sin at the same show I went to, right? I think Ken did. And take two. Hello, Ken.
Hey, Michael Butler, this is Ken from Orange County, New York, calling in with a show review of the Biters. They were in Poughkeepsie, New York, Memorial Day weekend, specifically Saturday, May 27th, in town for a show at The Loft. For those who don't know where Poughkeepsie is, I'd say it's about halfway between Albany and New York City. And
I played Poughkeepsie when I was in Exodus. We played, I think we played Poughkeepsie with, we might have done Poughkeepsie with Black Sabbath, and we also did another show in Poughkeepsie with Body Count and
DRI. Obviously lived near Poughkeepsie, so was happy to be able to go to the show, see the Biters. Poughkeepsie does not get a lot of great bands, maybe a few every year, so when I saw the Biters, I knew it was one that I had to get a ticket for and to go to. Probably about maybe 75 people at the show.
Huh.
I would say the loft can probably hold
what day of the
maybe
week
200,
was
so the place was about half full. True to its name, the loft is above a restaurant. You go up a flight of stairs and you sort of enter into this sort of nondescript room, really. It's not much of a club. It's more sort of cement wall, cement floor, and a stage sort of in the center. And, you know, if it's a band you really like, it's a great chance to see them because there's really not much keeping you between you and the band. It's just sort of a big open room.
Right.
So so that's the loft. The opener after a couple of local bands was, I guess, their touring opener called Frankie and the Studs. Frankie turns out to be female. Wasn't expecting that, I guess, because of their name. But at any rate, I would call the lead singer, I guess Frankie, sort of a cross between maybe Joan Jett and Susie Quattro.
That
if you
sounds
remember
great.
Susie Quattro from the 70s.
Do I remember Susie Quattro from the 70s? Yes, she's one of my all-time favorites. I had her on the Rock and Roll Geek Show. Cross between Susie Quattro and Joan Jett. What is it, Frankie? What's her name? Oh, you know who that is? Isn't that Gilby Clark's daughter? What's, let me see, let me rewind it.
Quattro, if you remember Susie Quattro. From
back it up here.
Frankie turns out to be female. Wasn't expecting that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's Gilby Clark's daughter.
At any rate, I would call the lead singer, I guess Frankie, sort of a cross between maybe Joan Jett and Susie Quattro, if you remember Susie Quattro from the 70s. Their songs were good. You can see why they were teamed up with the Biters for this tour. They kind of have a similar sound to them. She was all in leather with black high-heeled boots and a four-piece band, a bass player, guitarist, and drummer. They did a cover of the 70s big hit Hot Child in the City, which kind of, I thought, was a good choice of a cover. I kind of fit where they were coming from in terms of their music. They were good as an opener. Nothing really bad to say about them. The only criticism I guess I would say is that, you know, while she had a defined look, the rest of the band all kind of looked like somebody different, so to speak. The guitarist had sort of a mop top Beatles haircut. The bass player had a shaved head and an earring, and the drummer had sort of a hipster beard and sort of like you know, some kind of fancy hair going on. So, you know, I guess if I was their manager, I would tell them, look, they all kind of have to get on the same page in terms of their presentation.
Okay.
You know, the Biters obviously all look like they go together. I mean, they're a unified front when they come out. Frankie and the Studs, yeah, pretty much they got it. You know, they look acceptable, but I guess if I was their manager, I would try to get them a little more on the same page in terms of how they looked. But anyway, their songs were fine, and they played for about a half hour. So then the Biters came on, and you know, I guess their touring is sort of a low-tech operation. I mean, they were literally like setting up their own instruments and
plugging
in their own.
The bass player for Frankie and the Studs is my friend Jimmy Miller, pretty sure.
Amps and all that kind of thing. So I didn't even see a roadie at all with them. So looks like it's sort of every man for themselves if you're touring in the Biters tour. In terms of the music, they opened with Restless Hearts, which I think is a good opener from Electric Blood. That's, I think, the first song on that album.
I can't sing their songs.
My favorite album, so I was happy to hear that as an opener. Then they went through really, I guess what you would say, most of their well-known songs or most of their better songs anyway. There's an older song of theirs that I like called Hang Around, which they did. Everybody seemed to really like that song. And basically everybody who was there really knew all the words and knew all the songs. So while the crowd was a little bit on the small side, crowd was enthusiastic and seemed to really be loving the performance. Other highlights of the show, they did their song 1975, which sounded really good live. I'm not really a fan so far anyway of the new album, although performed live, I guess without some of the studio magic, the song sounded pretty good. So I actually ended up buying
That's
the CD on the way out.
That
so
is good to hear.
Give the CD another chance. They, in addition to all, you know, their, I guess, better known songs, they did a cover as an encore, Tom Petty's American Girl.
She was an American girl.
Sounded great. They did a great job with it and, you know, sort of fit in with the kind of music they were playing. So I thought that was a well-placed cover. They had a new bass player. Tuck was mentioning from the stage that I guess their former bass player quit a few days before the tour started. And they got this new fellow named Ryan, I think
name
was. And I guess he learned the songs in about 3 days.
So they got the bass player that they had replaced one of their brother. I believe his brother was the bass player, and they got a new guy. Now they replaced him too, huh? Interesting.
It was great. You wouldn't know that he was new to the band or was never a full time member. He looked the part. He sounded the part. You know, he must have fronted or been part of many other bands because he clearly was engaged with the audience and seemed to be having a great time. So in terms of, you know, a new bass player, he was right in step with the music and the production and the performance and everything else. So he did a great job. The rest of the show kind of went as you would expect. As I said, most of their well-known songs. I think they ended up doing two encores, two songs each, and that was it. So the show concluded, I'd say, around midnight. I bought the new CD, bought a T-shirt, and that was the night. You know, there's really, I have to say that the band really has it all together. I mean, there's really nothing keeping them from being more popular in terms of, you know, their experience, the way they play, the way they perform. They've got it all going on. So, you know, with the right song on the right soundtrack or the right break somewhere, you could see them really widening their audience. So,
They went on tour with Blackberry Smoke, and they're probably going back. I heard they're going back out on tour with Blackberry Smoke. That will widen their audience. Headlining 75 people headlining on I'm guessing was a weekend. That's probably about right in the United States. That's how it is for rock and roll bands touring the United States. Unless you're like getting a big push, I would bet Blackberry Smoke doesn't draw more than 200 people in the States. I could be wrong, but that's my guess.
Be a band that a lot of people should be listening to now, and a band that, you know, rock and roll and the radio stations really need something like this right
what
now.
Radio
but,
stations?
You know, the current state of music, who knows where they'll go? Maybe no farther than they've gone so far. But at any rate, it was a good show. Glad I went, and I would definitely go back and see them again. I mean, it was that kind of a show where if they came through next year and the year after, you'd kind of go every year because you know it's a quality show and you know what you're getting, and the songs will always be good. So that's it for the Biters at the Loft in Poughkeepsie, New York. This is Ken from Orange County. Hope you enjoyed the review, and stay frosty.
Stay frosty, friend. You too can leave a show review. You can do like Ken did and email it to me. He recorded on his phone. If you have an iPhone, I don't know how it works with the Androids, but if you have an iPhone, you have an app called Voice Memos. Just click record. Record yourself reviewing a show, and then press share and share it with rockandrollgeek@gmail.com, and I'll get it. That's the easiest way to send me a show review, and it's probably the ones that sound the best. Or you can call my Skype number, area code 706-621-ROCK. That's area code 706-621-7625. All right. I got an email. We're going to do one more thing, and then we'll do the track-by-track of the Danzig. I got an email from Steve Wagner. Is it Cheap Trick or just a cheap trick? Something to that. Something like that. What exactly does he say? Let me pull up my Gmail, rockandrollgeek@gmail.com. Is it Cheap Trick or a cheap trick? He says, "Hi, Michael. I thought you might appreciate this track, which sounds to my ears like early Cheap Trick pre-Heaven Tonight. What do you think? Is this Cheap Trick or who is this?" The song has no title and no He doesn't say the name of the band. So, first of all, is this Cheap Trick or a Cheap Trick imitation? Let's listen. I can tell you right now, it's not Cheap Trick. One, that guitar tone is way too thin. Two, that bass player is playing way too busy to be Tom Petersen. It's more of a new wave sounding bass part. Does sound a little bit like Robin Zander there. He's a little bit off key. Steve, I know who this is. It's not Cheap Trick. I will tell you who it is, Steve. I don't know the name of this song, but I'm pretty sure it's a band called 2020. I'm going to wow you with my knowledge, Steve Wagner. 2020 is from the Midwest. The guy, the Plimsolls, I believe, and what's his name? What's that fucking guy? Phil Seymour. What's Phil Seymour's band called? Dwight Twilley and Phil Seymour and Dwight Twilley, they're also from the Midwest somewhere, and they followed those guys out there. Those guys moved out there, and they followed them out there. Oklahoma, I think, is where they're from. That song, not that great. It doesn't sound like early pre-Heaven. Here's what pre-Heaven Tonight Cheap Trick sounds like, Steve Wagner. No comparison. Yeah, that's what pre-Heaven Tonight Cheap Trick sounds like. But here is a better song by 2020. This song is called Sherry or Cherry.
Sherry, Sherry,
There you go. 2020. So was it Cheap Trick or was it a cheap trick? It was a cheap trick by the name of 2020. That was they kind of fell in line with the power pop bands of the Knack and Plimsolls, the Producers. What was that? Probably around 1982 or something like that. I'm not good with the dates on the power pop because power pop is not. I'm not an authority on that, but I did know that. I do know that is 2020, and the band that he sent me was also 2020. I'm pretty sure. Correct me if I'm wrong, Steve Wagner, rockandrollgeek@gmail.com. All right, you ready to do a track-by-track of the new Danzig Black Laden Crown? Know nothing about this album, have not heard it at all. But hey, we're only 39 minutes into the show, and I need some material. So, all right, Black Laden Crown, the 11th studio album, and the 10th of all new original material. So the last one, I think the last one was a covers album. It was horrible. Danzig, he did a Misfits reunion. I think he did like one or two reunion shows with Misfits. Let me take a sip of this fine Tecate before we get into this track by track of Black Laden Crown. Ah! It's the band's first album of original material since Death Red Sabaoth in 2010. Marking the longest gap, but I'm reading this on the Wikipedia, by the way. Marking the longest gap between two studio albums in his career, as well as the first release with drummer Joey Castillo since I, Luciferi in 2002. The album took 3 years to complete, with the recording sessions beginning February 2014. It was recorded with five different drummers, Joey Castillo, Johnny Kelly, Carl Rockfist, who plays drums with Michael Monroe, great drummer, Dirk Van Beering, and Glenn Danzig himself played drums, while the bass parts were handled by both Tommy Victor and Glenn Danzig. So Tommy Victor plays in Prong. Little known fun fact, your friend Michael Butler here went and auditioned for Prong right after Exodus got dropped by Capitol. I flew to New York and auditioned for Prong, and I did not get the gig, even though I played the songs quite well. I thought I did it pretty good, actually, but I didn't get the gig. Maybe either I wasn't New York enough, or I think I wasn't, maybe wasn't a big enough name. He had the guy from what's that band, one of those industrial type bands. Anyway, forget, you know which band I'm talking about. Tommy Victor, a good guitar player, and Prong was a good band. When I played in this band Mind Zone with Billy Rowe, they were a lot like Prong. All right. What else about this album? It was produced by Glenn Danzig. It's on Evil Live, which is a Nuclear Blast, which is a Century Media property. First song is called Black Laden Crown. There are 9 songs on the album, so you know the scoring system. Let me find an envelope to write on here. Let's see, what was this? I don't know what that. I better not use that. That's probably a credit card bill. I don't want to use that. Let's see. How about here's a credit card. Another credit card bill, which I probably won't be paying anytime soon. I'll use the back of that. All right, Danzig. There are 9 songs on the album. If I like all 9 of them, we give it a 9 out of 9. If I like the song, I give it a +1. If it's okay, I give it a half. And if it's I'll give it a 0. First song, Black Laden Crown. Here we go. Now, being that I'm not a huge Danzig fan, I'm going to try to... I know Dave Slusher says I should not do it this way, but I'm going to look at it in the ears of a Danzig fan. I kind of like that riff. We'll drummer on this song is Johnny Kelly. Johnny Kelly played drums for Typo Negative.
I will lay down on a wild.
Can we turn the vocals up a little in the mix?
As your eyes open wide.
You can tell Glenn Danzig produced this one.
Let your heart lead to die.
I think the guitar sounds kind of like it's coming from a Line 6 amp or something like that. A little thin. Kind of a dirge, like a funeral dirge. Maybe that's the theme of the album. They're marching down the funeral. Five minutes and 59 seconds of dirge. Do I not like it? Do I like it? I don't hate it. Vocals a little too high in the mix. I'm gonna give it a half. Yeah! Those guitars could be a lot heavier sounding. They don't. They sound weak. No offense, Tommy Victor, but those guitars sound thin, dude. I've heard enough of that one. Next song, Eyes Ripping Fire. Drums on this, Glenn Danzig. Glenn Danzig also plays bass on this. And rhythm guitar. Or Tommy Victor might play bass on this. Eyes ripping fire. What tuning is that? Tune down to D. Which most people think, oh, it's going to be heavier because we tuned down to D. It's going to be heavier. I disagree. I don't think tuning down makes you sound heavier.
That's where I live. Strong with my back to the darkest stone. Never end. Beyond the night, beyond the veil.
One thing you gotta hand to Glenn Danzig, the guy's got an original, he's got a recognizable voice. Is it original? I guess it is original, but it's very recognizable.
Eyes ripping fire, come burning stale, forever saves.
Again, it's just chugging E's.
Oh, Messiah.
Or in this case, D's.
One flash of light is all you say.
Listen to Glenn Danzig's drumming.
Hot on the heels of a setting sun.
Very basic drumming. Sounds like how I would play drums.
The black sun never ends. Beyond the night, beyond the bell, beyond the mystery.
fans, it's all right. It's not catchy like, Mother, tell your children not to go my way. It's not as good as that one, but it's all right. I give it a half. Is this track by track going to be a bomb? It might be. All right. Next song, Devil on Highway 9, which this was, I think, the first single. Devil on Highway 9. Here we go. Again, thin sounding guitar. Don't you want it to sound like bombastic guitar? I would want to have stacks of Marshalls. It sounds like a Line 6. Sounds cheap. Sounds like it could be plugged directly into the computer in one of those computer plug software plugins. Sounds, tone is horrible. And Tommy Victor's gonna come kick my ass for saying that, but man, that tone is horrible. Again, way down tuning. Drums on this one, Joey Castillo.
Miles of the blackest road you can drive. Don't look to the left.
Joey Castillo played drums in Queens of the Stone Age, Eagles of Death Metal, California Breed, Zilch, and Scott Weiland and the Roundabouts.
Keep your hands on a wheel, make those tires peel.
He also plays with Zakk Wylde in the Black Sabbath cover band Zakk Sabbath.
Devil on Highway 9. Devil on Highway 9.
This whole album sounds like it was recorded in Glenn Danzig's house.
Devil on Highway 9.
They like demo quality.
Devil on Highway 9. Devil to the metal, let that engine roll. Got 100 miles left to go. Keep your eyes on the line. Don't you waste no time and leave the chips in your dust to cry. Devil
I guess I'll give that one a half as well. That's leaning on zero. All right, next song, Last Ride. This song was originally set to appear on the soundtrack for Walking Dead TV series, but the soundtrack never came to pass. The whole album never came to pass. This song is called Last Ride, featuring drumming by Joey Castillo again. No, wait, no. This is fourth song. Last Ride. This features drumming from Glenn Danzig. Does that have a finger snapping in it? With a reverb? A reverb finger snap?
Chills my side, and then there's nothing till the sunlight cries. The glazing eyes out full of flies.
Glenn Danzig said about this song that if the Walking Dead soundtrack album never came out, or he says, here's what he says. I had told people that if the soundtrack doesn't come out before my new album is being done, I'm putting it on my new record, man. It's not so much about the show itself, but more about the theme anyway. But who knows? If I do a video clip for it, it could even have zombies.
When the world has gone inside.
know, something about this album does sound evil, though, doesn't it? Maybe if that's the effect, then it's a good album, I guess. It sounds scary. Scary and poorly recorded. Doesn't that sound like 20th Century Boy? Listen. I'm gonna be your boy. Alright, another half. So far we're 2 out of 4. Next song, The Witching Hour, featuring the drumming of Johnny Kelly. Johnny Kelly of Typo Negative. Oops, sorry. While this rolls, I'm my third beer in since we started the show. I'm going to have to use the bathroom, so I'm going to let this song roll while I empty the you-know-what.
And the clock strikes one.
Can you turn the guitar, turn the vocals up in the mix a little bit?
With a gun, yeah, the witching hour comes upon all the willing ones. And the hand strikes loose on the river stairs. And the witching hour long past it raise a solemn train.
Clock strikes 18.
Nothing like you've ever seen. Cause a witching hour's drawing near. Oh, your darkest fear.
Does clock strikes 18, does that mean Adolf Hitler?
Strikes one. A day with the gown.
I actually kind of like this song, believe it or not. Alright, I'm going to go out on a limb and give that one a plus one. What do you think of that? Alright, next song is called But a Nightmare. again, that guitar sounds like it's coming through a line six. Sounds like Scorpions, the Zoo. Or is it Animal Magnetism? One of those tones.
I am but a nightmare lurking in your darkest dream.
Yeah. Creeping like Dick Verberin on drums on this tune.
To say, I am just a demo waiting for
Dick Verberin. Is from Belgium. He played in Swedish melodic death metal band Soilwork. As of 2016, he left Soilwork to join Megadeth as a full-time member. The guy's highly renowned in the metal scene for his studio recordings and live performances and recordings with Devin Townsend. Satyricon, Aborted, Naglfar, Scarve, Power Mad, The Project Hate, and many more.
Nothing more, nothing less. Praying on the weakest, I'll stand.
He's also a drum teacher. What did I just do? Fuck, let me back at him.
I am just a specter floating right above your face.
Alright, so I'm gonna give that one a half. No zeros so far. Alright, the next song is called Skulls and Daisies. Skulls and Daisies. Again, with the drop tuning, the let me see if that. Let me pull out my guitar here. Yeah. Maybe it's not tuned. Let's see. It's only tuned down a half step.
Down Louisiana, alligator room and breathe. Chong-chong green and nighttime, barren summer day. Girl routine alone. Ain't got her no man. Would I like to come and see the bloody dice?
Kind of like this one.
To come and see the bloody dice. Said I free your girl.
Drums on this one, Glenn Danzig.
Yeah,
he's barely playing drums. I'm telling you, I guarantee this was recorded in his house. Why not record in your house? It's going to sell just as many copies. It's actually going nowhere. I went from kind of liking it to kind of disliking it. Alright. That one gets a zero. I went from liking it to not liking it. So went from a one to a zero very fast. Next song is called Blackness Falls. Motherfucker. It's not motherfucker. It's just Blackness Falls. Blackness Falls. You're starting up all these songs in the same key. Bad move, bad move, bad move, bad move. Joey Casillo on drums. Danzig gets girls? I bet he does.
Shadow girls, shadow rain.
The guy is buff as hell.
It takes too late.
Blackness falls upon your cheek.
I picture him living alone
and
being angry all the time. I bet he's probably just like a super nice guy. Very easygoing vegetarian. At one time, Danzig was huge. He might still be huge. He just headlined some big festival like a week ago.
Darkness seeps into your blood.
All right, I'll give it a half. Next song, featuring Carl Rockquist on Rockvist on drums. Carl Rockquist plays with Michael Monroe. That's how I know him from. He played with the Chelsea Smiles, who I also know Chelsea Smiles, Todd Youth's band. Great drummer, that guy. He also played in Son of Sam. And he played in Steel Prophet and played with Ginger from the Wild Hearts as well. Or no, actually didn't play with Ginger. Well, Ginger was in Michael Monroe's band when Carl Rockquist joined the band. And he continues to play with Michael Monroe. All right. Pull the Sun, last song on the album.
Sun into your eye. They lost their glow. No surprise. Gray morning comes into your eye.
Most melodic song on the album. Again, those guitar tones kill it. And the guitar and the vocals are way too loud. Think Glenn Danzig does drugs or drinks? I'm guessing he's straight edge. I could be wrong. This album sounds like it was done on a lot of pot.
Stars out of the night.
I like this song. The production is just horrible.
I give them to you.
I'm gonna give it a +1. What do you think of that? All right, let's tally it up, shall we? Why am I yelling?
See how the shine.
Which, by the way, person who emailed me and said my chair squeaks, this is what squeaks. That's my keyboard sliding in and out of the desk.
The stars down from the sky.
All right, let's tally it up. Nine songs. We give it, well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 out of 9. You know what? I think that's a pretty damn accurate score.
Get it right.
If you agree with me that this is a 5 out of 9 and the guitar tones suck and the vocal... All right. Send me an email to rockandrollgeek@gmail.com with the subject line. Butler, you're absolutely right. Glenn Danzig seems like he lives at home and smokes a lot of pot and is a vegetarian. And loves animals, has a little cat, kitten, and a rabbit in his bedroom. Put that in the subject line.
No surprise.
If you disagree with me on the 5 out of 9, send me an email to rockandrollgeek@gmail.com or just record it and tell me. Butler, you sorry piece of shit. How dare you badmouth Danzig, the almighty Glenn Danzig. And even more, how dare you say anything about the great Tommy Victor's guitar tone? Put that in the subject line. If you disagree with me, rockandrollgeek@gmail.com.
All
right. I think I'm going to wrap it up now. I got to go to bed. I'm going to look at my new Gibson RDR, this bass. I play it a while. I was going to do a listening with Butler on this band Hell on Wheels. I'll save that for the next show. This song's growing on me. Because Carl Rockfist is playing drums on it. Thank you for listening, friends. Please keep the donations coming. Your donations keep the show going. And thank you, everybody, for listening. We'll talk to you very soon. I'm going to see Martina this weekend, and I'm very much looking forward to seeing my daughter. It's been a long time. I miss her very badly. Find me on the Facebook, R&R Geek. Find me on the Twitter, R&R Geek. Find this show at rockandrollgeek.com. Find me on the Instagram, rockandrollgeek. Don't ask. We'll talk to you very soon. Hopefully I'm mad at Dad coming up soon. And another Rock and Roll Geek show, too. If I can figure something to talk about. Give me some suggestions, friends, for Will It Hold Up? Or Classic Albums Revisited, or whatever you want me to do. This is your show, friends. All right. We'll talk to you soon.
It's a Rock and Roll Geek train wreck.